quorum. Salvo. Councillor Feeney. Councillor Lamatina. Councillor Linehan. Councillor Murphy. Councillor O'Malley. Councillor Presley. Councillor Ross.
Present.
Councillor Turner. And Councillor Yancey.
I've been informed by a clerk that a quorum is present. I'd ask all those present to please find a seat. There are seats in the room, and if you could please take a seat as opposed to standing in the hallway, we would appreciate that. We will begin this meeting today with a moment of silence and then a pledge of allegiance. So if we could have a brief moment of silence, please. Thank you. If you'll join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice. You may be seated. Mr. Clerk, if you'll just read the first docket.
Docket number 1647, call for a special meeting of the Boston City Council.
That matter shall be placed on file. I'd like to welcome all those present today at this public meeting of the City Council. The open meeting law normally favors the public discussion of issues. However, there are some exceptions. For instance, to discuss the character and reputation of a member of the body, the open meeting law allows for private communication among members of the council. However, the member in question has the opportunity to elect that that meeting be held in public. Councilor Turner has elected to do so. Though we appreciate the presence of the public here today, our council rules are very clear that this is an internal discussion of council members, and so we will not be taking public testimony today. I'd like to take a moment to outline the process for today's meeting. The clerk has in his possession the order outlining the motion of this meeting, which he'll read in a moment. Once the order is introduced and it receives a second, Councilor Turner will have the opportunity to speak, followed by each of his councilors who chooses to do so. Councilor Turner will then have a final opportunity to speak before the roll call is called. And the with regard to the Councilor Turner's vote, we have been advised, and Councilor Turner has been advised, that the conflict of interest law prevents his ability to take a vote on this particular matter because it affects him. And he has, as I understand, agreed with that. And so as a result, 12 people will be voting, meaning that 8 votes are necessary to approve any order from this meeting. During the debate, councillors will have the opportunity to amend what is being put forward and will be read by the clerk. The amendment only needs a majority of city councillors, so of 12, that would be 7. Mr. Clerk, if you'll read the relevant portion of Rule 43 regarding conduct in the council.
Under City Council Rule Number 43, no demonstrations of approval or disapproval from members of the public will be permitted, including but not limited to signs, placards, banners, cheering, clapping, booing, etc.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk, will you now read docket 1648?
Docket number 1648, order to discuss that under the authority vested in the City Council by Statute 1951, Chapter 376, Section 17, and pursuant to the procedures set forth in City Council Rule 40A, the City Council, in consideration of his qualification to serve as a member of the Boston City Council, now moves that Councilor Turner vacate the office of City Councilor effective Friday, December 3rd, 2010.
The matter requires a second. Councilor Murphy seconds the motion, the order. Chair recognizes. I wanted to afford Councillor Turner with the opportunity to speak first. However, if he yields, Chair recognizes Councillor Yancey.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I hereby request that the clerk read rule number 33 and rule number 47.
Mr. Clerk, will you please read the rules?
Rule 33, adoption of matters on day introduced. No ordinance, substitution of an ordinance, order, or resolution may be adopted at the meeting at which it is submitted. This rule may be only suspended with unanimous consent. This rule applies only to matters not previously filed for council consideration and assigned to committee and any related amendments or substitutions, and does not apply to reports of committee chairs. And rule 47?
Yes.
Rule 47. I'm on the mic. Rule 47, suspension of rules, with the exception of Rule 5. All portions of the council rules that require compliance with the open meeting law and portions of the rules mandated by city charter, which may not be suspended, and Rules 12, 33, and 35, which may be suspended only by unanimous consent. The foregoing rules shall not be altered, amended, suspended, or repealed at any time, except by a vote of two-thirds of all members of the council. Provided, however, that Rule 12 may be suspended only in the case of an order, ordinance, vote, committee report, or other measure submitted by the mayor or by a councilor calling for action by the council that is of any emergency nature, namely that which imposes an imminent threat to the peace, health, and safety of the people or their property.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Councillor Yancey, you have the floor.
Mr. President, I hereby object to these proceedings. It is not allowed in our rules that we take action on a matter submitted on the same day. And it's my understanding that this matter was presented to the City Council on December 1st, 2010. And if there's any action at all that's going to be taken by this body that requires unanimous consent, I hereby object.
Thank you. Your objection is duly noted. The council will be under brief recess so we can assess your objection. First and foremost, Councilor Turner brought to my attention that there are people standing outside in the hallway. We have made provisions to open up the Curly Room, and there is a television in there with sound, and we would invite those people to essentially walk around through the front of the City Council and enter through there to go into the Curly Room, and you're welcome to sit there and to be able to listen to these proceedings. So they are opening that now, and hopefully you'll be able to be in there in a few minutes. Councilor Yancey, we've reviewed your parliamentary procedure point, and it is the call of the chair that your point is not of my opinion. Rule 40A, which is why we are here today, is what governs. Rule 40A does not contemplate filing this matter in a committee. Rule 33 does contemplate filing an order, an ordinance, a resolution to a committee. And it is Rule 33 which requires which does not allow for the same day of acting. And so therefore, your point of parliamentary procedure is denied.
Mr. President.
Councilor Yancey.
I believe Rule 47 mentions motion. Any motion, is that correct?
Rule 47 does not include Rule 40A. Rule 40A does not require the matter to be put in committee, and as a result, the matter does not require action on the same day, is not precluded from action on the same day.
Mr. President, I object. I think it's very, very clear that you have proposed a motion that is clearly mentioned within both Rule 33 and Rule 47. And it states that we can't, that any member of this body can object to a proceeding such as what's being proposed here today. And the purpose of that is to allow each member the opportunity to effectively do the study and research necessary before being asked to vote on the matter, present it to us on the same day. Those are our rules. If you choose to ignore that, Mr. President, you do that at your own peril. This is a very serious matter. We do not have... But what you have proposed...
One moment.
Yes.
Just a reminder, a gentle reminder, if I may, the rules of our council for any hearing, for any matter whatsoever, prevent any show of support or show of opposition. So I'd ask that you please refrain from either. Thank you. Councilor
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. President. The purpose of this rule, and I'm the longest serving member of the Boston City Council. I've been here 27 years. I have read the rules for 27 different city council sessions. I am not a novice. And the reading of Rule 33 and Rule 47 could not be clearer. And neither makes reference to referring matters to committee, as you just stated, neither. So, Mr. President, with all due respect, Rule 47 reads, with the exception of Rule 5, and I can get to Rule 5 if you like, all portions of city, excuse me, it says all portions, A-L-L, all portions of the City Council rules that require compliance with the open meeting law and portions of the rules mandated by the City Charter, which you make reference in your order, may not, which may not be suspended, Rule 12, 33, 35, which may be suspended only by unanimous consent. If you decide, Mr. President, to ignore your own rules and to make up the rules as we go along, then you're making a complete travesty, not only of what's happening today, but of the entire Boston City Council. So I demand that we refrain from taking any action today as a result of a motion made by the President. I don't think it's proper, I don't think it's legal, and I think it violates our rules, specifically Rule 33 and Rule 47. Again, you're the President of the City Council, but even you are not above the rules of this Council. and I will not stand by silently while efforts are underway to remove any member of this body, even yourself, Mr. President, because I believe that we live in a democracy, and it is not the authority that was granted to any of us when we were elected to decide the will of the people. And we have a rule which you are relying on in offering these proceedings, and I simply request, no, I demand that you abide by the rules. And if we have discussions, that's one thing. But before voting on any motion and taking any action, be cognizant, and the mayor's attorney, I mean, the corporation's counsel is here, be cognizant that this can be subject to challenge in the future. We've had instances in the past in the city council where the city council took action against city council employees, only to be sued and to lose in that case, precisely because we did not follow our own rules. Now, you're going to ask us to abide by one set of rules but ignore other sets of rules. It does not work like that, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councillor Yancey. I understand your... I understand the point you're making today. I understand it well. I've told you I disagree with your point. I have been advised by all legal counsel and all parliamentarians that your read on this is incorrect. I will ask the corporation counsel and his assistant corporation counsel to illuminate this issue a little bit more, and then I'm going to move on. Corporation Counsel or Mary Beth, whichever you choose.
Rule 40A, by design, is intended to present a matter going to the qualifications of a member to the council as a whole, to the entire council. It's our position that Rule 33 and Rule 47 are implicated when a matter is destined for assignment to committee. In fact, Rule 33 states, that this rule may be only be suspended with unanimous consent. This rule applies only to matters not previously filed for council consideration and assigned to committee. It's our position that this is not a matter which would lend itself to be assigned to committee, that adequate notice was presented to Councillor Turner and to all councillors, and therefore the provisions cited by Councillor Yancey are inapplicable. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Turner, I will now offer you the opportunity to make any statements you so choose.
Thank you. You know, I understand that this is a difficult situation for all of us. But let me begin not by focusing on the motion, but by focusing on my relationship with all of you over the last, with some 11 years and with others of you, a smaller number. While we haven't agreed all of the time, where we have had differences of opinion, debates, even anger around differences, I really appreciate the fact that we have been able to move beyond that and work together. You know, so whatever happens today, you have to understand that I appreciate the fact that we have been able to work together as a group of men and women focused on not only our own personal welfare, but the welfare of the people of this city. I can say with all sincerity that I'm honored to have served as a member of the City Council and to have served with you all. I can understand, you know, when I say that, that through each and every one of your minds is going the thought then, Chuck, why are you doing this? to us. I can appreciate that. You know, I understand politics. Why are you, we didn't create this situation, and you're right, you didn't create it. U.S. Attorney Sullivan created it when he decided to use his legal powers to take down Senator Wilkerson and myself. You didn't create it, but you're an elected official. And so as an elected official, you have responsibilities to deliberate on a variety of issues. And in this case, you are being asked to deliberate on the question of whether I'm qualified. You have to understand that from my perspective, I know I am as qualified to serve as each and every one of you, morally and physically, based on my actions in this council chamber over the last 11 years. I'm not going to go through the issues of my voting against the pay raise or having difference in opinion on whether we should give our monies to a Arthur Wynn or a Liberty Mutual with their $1 billion of profit. You know, we all know. We all know what went on in those sessions. But I don't think any one of you, I don't think any one of you could say that in the day and in and day out work of this council, I have been someone who looked at personal gain. I don't think you can say that. And I think that's important for you to acknowledge, because the reality is that the conviction that is being used as the reason for my removal, for the reason to move you all to the position to judge my moral character, was a setup. I'm not going to retry the case, but I would point out that our council president is a man of the law. A number of you are men of the law, and you know that the power to go after government officials is a very dangerous power. It's a kind of power that creates fascist states, states where justice ceases to be the issue, and where the issue is the prosecutor's desire to eliminate forces that get in the way of what he or she or they are doing. As a lawyer and as a person who has served with me for 11 years, you know that the initiation of a sting investigation, whether they paid $30,000 to their hired agent or $1,000 to their hired agent, that a sting operation has to be justified by a record of improper behavior. That's a tremendously important rule that should restrain prosecutors, from being able to pick out anyone. But it didn't restrain U.S. Attorney Sullivan. And it's particularly of concern to me as a person who has spent my life fighting for justice that we aren't even talking about the fact that in 2005, the U.S. Attorney General, or maybe it's 2006, was essentially kicked out of office. Why was he kicked out of office? Because the Bush administration that appointed Michael Sullivan to be U.S. Attorney had been using fired eight U.S. attorneys. Why did they fire them? Because they wouldn't pursue criminal prosecutions. And what happened to Michael Sullivan? He wasn't fired. He was given a promotion. Remember, he was given the job of being head of ATF, in addition to being head of the U.S. Attorney's Office, I mean, U.S. Prosecutor. I mean, isn't that interesting? After Bush fired 8 U.S. attorneys because they wouldn't pursue criminal prosecutions. And then what, the next year, what was he doing? He was pursuing Senator Wilkerson and I. I can't speak to Senator Wilkerson, but I can speak to myself. There wasn't a justification for that. If I had pleaded entrapment, I would have walked out of that court with a not guilty verdict, because any lawyer who looks at it would have to say that if you committed the crime, Chuck, it was entrapment. The problem that we had was that I didn't commit the crime. Plead entrapment because I'm a man of principle, not political expediency. If I believed in political expediency, I wouldn't have gotten on that stand and testified. But I believe each and every public official accused of corruption has a responsibility to be a person of principle and get on that stand and face the prosecutor and the jury and speak the truth. If they don't believe you, then you have to face consequences. But if you're going to be a man or a woman who's worthy of the office, you have to, you know, take that step. And so I couldn't lie about doing the crime because I didn't do it. Otherwise, we wouldn't even be here today. So you have a very difficult choice before you, because people don't think critically in this society. They don't. The media has turned us into sheep, where we just follow along with what they say. We don't think for ourselves, and so the media creates this frenzy. Focus. 2 years ago, being in a conspiracy, talking to each other. But you know what happened at the trial? Doing something together, because I guess they thought that if they put both us together, then that would really community. You know, and that was the purpose, right? That was the purpose, to take us down, because they saw the power of communities of color rising, just like the Irish power rose. And you know what? They manipulated you. It took 40 years. The police commissioner of Boston in 1920. We can't entrust the public safety of Boston to the appointee of an Irish mayor. And they held it. The licensing commission, it's really the licensing commission. They're appointed by the governor. Why? Because the state legislature said, we won't allow the mayor of Boston, the Irish mayor of Boston, to appoint the licensing commission, because they don't have the moral standards to do that. They did that to you. That was political, not legal. Yes, they put the laws there. They're on the books. You know, the laws were there, but were those laws just laws? Laws? Did your grandmother and grandfather think it was just that the mayor of Boston couldn't appoint the police commissioner? Was that justice? No, it was a law, but it wasn't a just law. That's why the Irish community elected Michael Kerr. Knew that the laws were controlled in many ways by the Yankees, and they weren't going to forget that they were at war with the Yankees. Now, the question is, why are you talking about Irish history? This has to be seen in the context of a transition in power, just like Irish, after being treated like dogs for 50 years in this city, began to develop their power and were able to out-organize and out-politicize the Yankees and were able to gain power. And what did they do? They used the law to come after you all. come after you. I've said a couple of things. I could go on and on. I'm sure your grandmothers and grandfathers took you on their knee, you know, took you into their history so that you could understand that the law is not just all the time, because the laws are made by human beings who use those laws to, in fact, continue to oppress. The Irish in this city know what its political oppression is about, because I've read your history. I know what you've gone through. And when I look at what Senator Wilkerson and I are going through, what U.S. Attorney Michael Sullivan, he should be ashamed, would be ashamed of Michael Sullivan as an Irishman to be doing this to black people, because Mayor Curley understood what justice was all about. So let me not take more time, but I think it's very important that you put my situation in the context of your history, because you know that the laws have been used to persecute the Irish in this very city. So don't act as if, and the, as well as the Italians, so don't act as if the only issue was whether I was convicted or not. You know, any scientist that the fruits of the tree are determined by the roots. What I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, is that that conviction was rotten. Why? Because the roots of the let me see. Didn't you read the two-page memorandum that Judge Mark Wolf last year issued to U.S. Attorney Sullivan, where he said, "I'm tired of you lie in my courts." A 42-page memorandum. The head of the federal bench in Massachusetts said that he was tired of Michael Sullivan lying, having his lawyers lie, and causing cases to be declared as mistrials because U.S. Attorney Sullivan had allowed his lawyers to lie in court. Can you imagine that? So if he was using them to lie, and one of them is still before the Board of Bar Overseers because Chief Justice has asked that he be debarred. So it's a complicated situation. Yes, people are looking at you and demanding that you, not many, based on the letters I'm getting, but some, are demanding that you remove me because I'm a convicted felon. But you know the story. You know the reality of who I have been with you. You know that you might not know that they were going after Senator Wilkerson, admitted in court that they were going after Senator Wilkerson through Councilor Turner in to see if he might take a bribe. What right did they have? What right did they have to use federal money to go after me? There has never been an accusation that I'm an inside player. They call me a crazy radical. I was pointed out one to take the fall. Now, why did they pick me? You know, I don't even need to talk about it. But the reality is they had no basis doing it. It was purely political. And do I have other evidence? Yeah, that when I wouldn't stop talking, and that was the purpose, to shut my mouth, because they knew in a city where the divide between the rich and the working class and the poor is getting wider and wider and wider, I'm a dangerous threat. I'm a dangerous threat because in my history of Boston, I have worked to bring
working class people of all races together to stand up and fight for our rights. Person has played the same role at the state level that I've been playing at the city level. So this is it was a criminal prosecution. My prosecution was a criminal prosecution. And so you're in a difficult situation because you have to choose between the conventional wisdom of a society that ignores the reality that justice, that laws and justice are bent and twisted by a society to serve its ends. And you have to choose between a society, between the views that says I'm a convicted felon and I have to be removed in order. It's a joke. And morality. And why do I say morality? Because I believe that if you look at what U.S. Attorney Sullivan did, you'd have to say that was the same kind of thing that the Yankees did to the Irish. And it wasn't fair when it was happening to your grandmothers and grandfathers, and it's not fair when it's happening to Senator Wilkerson and I today. And you have to choose. I'm going to end now. But to say, before you vote, go inside yourself. Go inside yourself. And ask yourself the question, am I more morally qualified to serve on this city council than Chuck Turner? Am I more morally qualified to serve on this council than Chuck Turner? Because if you don't believe that you're morally qualified, more morally qualified than I to serve on the city council, you can't vote to remove me morally from a political process of political expediency. Each of you could do that. Of course you can do that. You have the power. But morality is a principle that we need to bring back to government, especially when you begin to talk about qualifications. If the councillors aren't morally qualified to serve, then I don't think they should serve. So the question for you, before you judge my qualifications, is do you think you're more qualified morally to serve than I? And it's a particularly important question for you as elected officials, because you sit in judgment of me today in terms of my moral qualifications, but the people of this city will sit in judgment of you in September of 2011 and in November of 2011. And they will be looking at the question, are those councillors who removed Councillor Turner? They said he wasn't morally qualified to serve, and they will be asking themselves, I wonder if the ones who voted to remove him are morally qualified to serve. Thank you. No, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor Turner, and thank you for your... Sir, I don't want to have to remove you. Thank you. Any of my colleagues, and I do see your blinking buzzer, prior to going back to Councilor Yancey, who's requested to speak again, any of my colleagues wishing to make any comments, please signify. Seeing and hearing none, Councilor Yancey.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'm very happy that we have the Corporation Counsel with us today. Even though He was hired and works for the mayor of Boston, who has called for Councillor Turner to resign. I expect him to maintain his integrity and to answer my questions concisely. So if I may direct questions to the Corporation Counsel.
Please.
Is there any explicit language in the charter for the city of Boston, not the United States Congress, not the state of Vermont, not the state of Washington, and you sent me those references and I appreciate it, but is there any explicit reference in the Boston City Charter that gives the Boston City Council members the authority to expel a fellow member?
Yes.
Could you cite that at this time?
Corporation Counsel, if you need appropriate time, please feel free to signify, and I'm happy to take a recess.
No, I'd be happy to respond immediately. The city charter states in section 17, among other items, the city council shall be the judge of the election and qualifications of its members. That same sentence goes on to state, and shall from time to time establish rules for its proceedings.
Yes, and I repeat my question.
No, you don't have to repeat your question, Counsel.
Because I asked if there was explicit language.
Counsel, if I could,
if you would allow Corporation Counsel to finish.
Thank you. Among the rules that is implicit in that statement is Rule 40A.
Counsel Yancey, I'm trying to allow Corporation Counsel the what I allowed you, which is the time to finish your sentence. So
Counsel, the word expulsion does not appear in the city charter. However, I think a reasonable man, and I know you are, would conclude that the authority embodied in the city charter to make rules from time to time includes Rule 40A. Thank you.
Mr. Sinnott, let me repeat what you just said to me. There is no explicit language in the Boston City Charter that gives members of the Boston City Council the authority to remove any other member. Is that what you just said to me, sir?
It depends.
No, explicit.
Counselor. Counselor, I'm not going to parse words with you.
I'm not asking you to.
And I'm not going to get into a debate with you. The word expulsion does not appear. If
you
want my reasonable interpretation, and
it's not what I asked.
It's not just my interpretation. It's the interpretation of the Supreme Judicial Court.
Yes, sir. I will call recess, and we will stop these proceedings. And then we will come back, and this will take much longer. Please allow the gentlemen to speak to each other. It's difficult enough to do this in this format. We're trying to work together here. Please allow that basic decency between the two of them. You may continue.
I'll conclude at this time, Mr. President.
Okay. Mr. President, and I certainly want to thank the Corporation Counsel for being here. My question had to do with what not your interpretation might be, because reasonable people do disagree from time to time. Even lawyers disagree from time to time. But my question was there any language in the Boston City Council and the city charter that authorizes the city council to remove any properly democratically elected member of this body? And your answer to me was no, there's no explicit language, although you have inferred that the implication of some words may well lead a reasonable person to believe that that means expulsion. But there's no explicit language. So I caution you again, Mr. President and great Corporation Counsel, I caution you to be very, very careful. Democracy is a precious thing. And you cannot abrogate to yourself authority and power which does not exist. For your convenience, or for the convenience of the mayor, or the president of the city council, or our colleagues, this is a very serious matter.
Council, you don't have to lecture me on how serious a matter this is. I'm well aware of my statutory powers here. I'm trying to answer your questions dispassionately. I'm trying to answer your questions reasonably, and I believe I've done so. Thank you.
Well, again, and I'll end in for the time being, Mr. President, I believe that we all know that Councilor Turner is not perfect. You know, I think we all know that he has made mistakes. We all know that he's not the greatest person in the world. But neither are we, and we all have made mistakes. But what's before us today is a serious matter, one that requires more deliberation than asking this body to vote on this matter the same day it's presented. And that's why we have rules in the City Council like Rule 33 and Rule 47, which you choose to ignore. But ignoring it doesn't make it go away. And I would just ask my colleagues, I know that many of my colleagues, and I love and respect and admire each and every one of our colleagues, they all work hard. They're all serious. And none of us want to be here today. I'd much rather be here talking about fighting to build a new high school for our children. Because we have 3,000 high school students going to non-high school buildings in the city of Boston today. Much rather be here coming up with a strategy to stop the violence in the streets of Boston. I'd much rather be here talking about we're reopening the 8 community centers which were closed, or the 4 libraries that are scheduled to close. I'd much rather be here talking about restoring positions in the Boston School Department rather than cutting them further. But we are here. Guess that's why we get paid the big bucks. And while I'm talking about big bucks, there's only one member of the Boston City Council who voted against a city council pay raise. And I'm not embarrassed to say that I was not that person. But Councilor Turner is the only member who voted against a pay raise. Is that because he was greedy? Is that because he was looking for a payoff? I don't think so. If I had any doubts in my mind that Councilor Turner needed to be bribed to advocate for any constituent or anyone, whether they live in the city or not, I would not be here supporting him today. So I know that the media, I know that historians will look upon this day since this has never happened before in the history of the Boston City Council. They will say that some of us did the right thing, some of us did the wrong thing. I'm not going to second guess any of my colleagues, but I do know that it requires, based on the rules that you promulgated, Mr. President, without mentioning expulsion of any member. But I know that requires 2/3 votes. I disagree with the ruling on conflict of interest, which excludes, essentially disenfranchises Councilor Turner from voting. But he decided to abide by that. Because as I just mentioned, this body votes for its own raises. What's more conflictual than that? But we have 3 choices if we're going to vote on this. We can vote to support the motion as offered by President Ross, and I maintain it will be an illegal act for us to take that action, but that's just my view based on my reading of the rules, and I am a product of the Boston Public School System, Tufts University, and Harvard University, and I think I can read. Or we can vote no or we can abstain. You need 8 positive affirmative votes to get your motion through, your ill-conceived motion through. And I ask all of our colleagues, again, I'm not going to question how you vote, but those of you who abstain, your vote's not going to be counted to oust Councillor Turner. Those of you who vote yes, your vote will be counted to oust him. Those of you who vote no will also be a vote against ousting one of our colleagues until at least we find whether or not he's going to be sentenced. So, Mr. President, thank you for your indulgence. If I have offended anyone, including you or the Corporation Council, I publicly apologize. That's not my intent. But one of the things that I try to do in my 27 years on this body is to communicate, and to communicate clearly, not to make inferences, not to talk about what the average thoughtful man or woman might think, but to read the language for what it says. The language of the City Council does not say we have the authority to expel any member. Rule 33 and Rule 47 says we should not vote on the matter the same day it's submitted. And it's apparent to me that there are individuals, I don't know how many, but there are those who feel very comfortable on the one hand saying that we have to live by the council rules, and on the same day and almost the same breath say we have to ignore two of them. So I, again, thank all of our colleagues. I apologize if I talked a little bit too long, but I wanted to communicate and be as explicit as possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Councillor Yancey. And Councillor Yancey, no, you have not offended me. Reasonable men and women have disagreed in this room for decades, and I appreciate our disagreement. I do wish to correct the record. I've already mentioned 33A and, I mean, Rule 33, and we don't need to go through that again, and I don't want this to be a parliamentary jousting match here. I want to put on the record, though, some what I believe are not correct statements. We have not moved in haste in any way, shape, or form on this matter. The council first had an opportunity to deal with this matter 2 years ago, after the arrest and after the indictment, more than 2 years, almost 3 years ago, after the arrest and after the indictment of Councillor Turner. It was at that time that the council had no rules in which to even judge its members. We, unlike other legislative bodies, had no rules, had no Rule 40A. And at that time, I sat with you, I sat with Councillor Turner, and I sat with the rest of our colleagues, and we came up with those rules together. And we voted on them together and unanimously. And there were two parts of that rule. And the first part was that in the event that a city councillor does something that's out of character, that it then become the call of the chair, the president of the council, to put forward a vote on that action. I felt then, and I felt today, that doing so would have been the wrong move. So I chose not to act. I believe that Councillor Turner was entitled to his day in court, to his defense, and to his presumption of innocence. And so we did not act, much to the disdain and scrutiny of the media at that time. And then on October 29th, when Councillor Turner was convicted of the felony, that triggered the second part of Rule 40A, which eliminated the discretion and requires the council president to issue an order. And that's what today's hearing is all about. Now, that was 1 month ago. We did not move in haste at that time, much to the criticism of people, local media. I didn't think it was prudent then for us to do that. Now, most recently, on November 29th, I submitted to you a very complete packet of information, along with Corporation Counsel's legal memo, that went into the details of why we do have the right to judge our members and to take action such as the action we're taking today. And it wasn't just limited to the charter of the City Council, which is effectively our constitution, if we can call it that, although that's relevant and that's part of it. The Corporation Council just outlined that to you. But it also outlined case law that goes back to 1874 and all the case law from since then. And it also outlined other matters and was fairly exhaustive on that. And this you received not today, this you received on Monday. And so I just wanted to place on the record that I do not believe we've been operating in haste. And it's not just the charter that governs our behavior here today. There are many other, and that information, that packet, is available to the public. It's available online. It was available since Monday. I would urge people to review it. We are taking action that we contemplated 2 years ago. We are giving a friend and someone that we would not want to be in this situation and something that does not reflect the character of who this person is, but nonetheless, we are taking steps that we set in motion 2 years ago that we all agreed to and that we all voted unanimously for. That is what is happening today. If any of other of my colleagues have anything they wish to say, I'm going to move the question. Final word?
Yes. I read the material that was provided this Monday. And it did make reference to cases in the state of Washington. It made references to a case involving a school committee that refused to sit a member. And the reason that school committee did not sit that member was the individual happened to have been female at a time when women were not allowed to vote. I also read the other comparisons, Mr. President, between the Boston City Council and the State House of Representatives. We are governed by totally different laws and rules. So with all due respect, while I digested and spent many, many hours going through this material, I could not find one instance where it said that the Boston City Council has the authority to expel any member. Even the Rule 40A that you refer to does not require the expulsion or doesn't even mention the expulsion. It doesn't say what action. We are not required by Rule 40 to expel any member.
That is correct.
And it almost begs the question, do we have any rules in the city charter with regards to the removal of any member of city government? And you know what? We do. We have the authority, the mayor has the authority to remove department heads. That's really the only instance where the city charter addresses the issue of removing a city official. So we're inventing as we go along. And with all due respect to my esteemed Corporation Counsel, he still fails to cite any instance that mentions the word expulsion or removal of a member of the Boston City Council. Nor, and I just add parenthetically, I'm not making this as a recommendation or a motion, nor does it mention how we would remove the mayor of Boston. Another instance where the city charter is silent on this very important issue. Now, the politically expedient thing for us to do, of course, would be to just follow the dictates of the media or others. But I was hired by the people of Boston to advocate for the people of Boston within the law. Within the law. And our rules, incidentally, city council rules are not ordinances. They're not statutes. They're not the law. They are means by which we try to govern ourselves, and we need rules. But even our rules happen to be silent on that very narrow question that I asked the Corporation Council. Very narrow. That was very deliberate. Does it explicitly give us the authority to remove any member? So you can interpret what qualifications mean, judge the qualifications. That's subject to interpretation. So why not use the explicit language if that's what Rule 40 was all about? So with all due respect, I would urge my colleagues to either vote no or to abstain, because while we had some of this material earlier this week, the rules that you put together, Mr. President, are very, very clear. It's not, it doesn't say when material was sent to the City Council. It says on the day action is requested. And that day is December 1st, 2010. Same day it's being submitted, same day you're seeking action. I think that's inappropriate. And again, I stand by my objection. Thank you.
Thank you. Duly noted. Chair recognizes Councillor Ayanna Pressley. Oh,
sorry. Just a moment.
Okay. Chair recognizes Councillor Felix Arroyo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not afraid to admit that the reality of this day and of this moment has weighed heavily on both my mind and my heart. All too often in politics and in our everyday discourse, we try to find things as define things as black and white, as clear cut, as if what is obvious to one person should be obvious to the other, when in reality we live in a world that is much grayer than we acknowledge. Every single person in this room has done things that we are proud of and things that we are not proud of. Every person in this room has been accused of doing wrong at least once in their life. And we all have those moments that we wish we could take back. In the end, we cannot escape our mistakes. We cannot escape our deeds. And sometimes even more troubling, we find it difficult to escape the perception of who we are. And we all know that reality does not always play a role when it comes to perception. The facts are the facts. Counsel Turner was indeed convicted of the worst crime a public official can be convicted of. And to many, that's what he's going to be remembered for. That conviction comes with many consequences, which include what many of us assume will happen today, and that is quite possibly his end at his time as a public official, which will mean I will not be able to serve out my first term with my friend and my former boss. After meeting with him yesterday, I learned that he also understands this. He has somehow found inner peace throughout this process. However, allow me to take a moment to speak about the man that I have come to know over the past 10 years of my life. As a young 20-year-old college student, he gave me the opportunity of a lifetime. He introduced me to public service, not just any type of public service, but service through organizing. The lessons I learned while in his office are still with me today. I learned that when a constituent reaches out to you, it's your responsibility to answer that call. I learned that real change comes through organizing and not politics. I learned that while the voice of the powerful can be deafening, we must do our best to often hear the silent voice of the powerless. I began to believe that someone like me, a Latino kid that went to the Boston Public Schools and Public University, can indeed dream of being elected in this city, my city, our city. I also learned that politics is temporary, and that for all of us, there will indeed be an end to our public service. I know that there are those that will see Councilor Turner as a villain, and there are those that will see him as a hero. However, I will neither put him on a pedestal nor push him off of it. To me, he's my friend. Man, I've grown to love, and someone I refuse to judge. The system that we're all a part of, that we all pledge allegiance to, where before we started this meeting, has already judged him. I will, however, stand here today as a city councilor. I will leave here as his friend. In the end, how I vote on the question of his expulsion has weighed heavily on me. And I realize it may cost me some friends. I will cast my vote. I will not run from my responsibility to vote. And I will live by my vote. I ask all of those watching to consider that sometimes there is no black and white. Frankly, we are usually in the gray. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else wish to speak on this matter? Chair recognizes Councillor Presley.
Thank you, Mr. President. I've learned a lot from Councillor Turner, which is why I too will not abstain. He's a man of strong conviction and has never run away from his responsibilities or making tough choices. It is with a heavy heart and extreme sadness that I intend to vote in the affirmative on Council President Ross's motion. In accordance with the rules duly established by this council, I understand and appreciate that for many people in this chamber today, there is nothing I can say at this moment to assuage your anger or to lessen your disappointment. And the truth is that I am also deeply troubled by the actions the federal government took in this matter. But this hearing is not a retrial. This hearing is not a retrial for Councilor Turner. The council does not have the authority to reverse the conviction, recommend sentencing, or to demand answers from the FBI. That is simply not our role. This is a terribly sad day. No one in this chamber, no one in this body.
Excuse me, Councilor Presley. I will clear this proceedings, and we will conduct the proceedings without you. I've asked you, I've begged you to please respect this difficult process for everyone. Councillor Turner has joined with that, I believe. Please do not outburst. Please allow Councillor Presley and anyone else who wishes to speak the opportunity to finish her statement. You may continue.
This is a terribly sad day, and no one in this chamber, no member of this body, not the mayor, not anyone in this city can deny that Councillor Chuck Turner is a man of deep conviction. He has taken principled and very lonely stands, waged politically unpopular battles, and spoken truth to power. He has shown up time and time again for his district and for me personally. His work ethic is legendary. Come to City Hall on any given night and you'll find him in his office diligently, personally responding to constituent emails. He has a long and distinguished record of advocacy on behalf of the voiceless and the victimized, on behalf of all Bostonians of all races and creeds and backgrounds who live on the margins. Chuck Turner paved the way for young electeds of color like me, and that is not lost on me. In my 11 months on this body, Chuck Turner has tremendously been supportive of me and my work. We have worked together on increasing the number of women in building trades, on diversifying our police force, on addressing rising rates of teen pregnancy, and combating violence in our city. Councillor Turner and I have not always agreed on everything. We have had our disagreements, but I've always known that Councillor Turner respected me as a colleague, respected me as a woman of color, and respected me as a partner in his advocacy. Chuck, you told me yesterday that no matter how I voted, you loved me. And I just want to say I love you too. That's between me and my colleague. This is an awful day. I am heartsick at what has come to pass. This council and this city, and I will personally feel the absence of Councilor Turner. I promise you that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll now ask the clerk. I will now ask the clerk to call a roll call. I'd ask you to do so, Mr. Clerk, beginning with the president, in an order of seniority.
Councillor Ross?
Yes.
Councillor Ross, yes. Councillor Yancey?
Another departure from the rules, Mr. President. Usually we go alphabetically.
Yes or no, Councillor Yancey?
The answer to your question, Mr. President, is no.
Councillor Feeney?
Yes.
Councillor Feeney, yes. Councillor Murphy?
Yes.
Councillor Murphy, yes. Councillor Consalvo? Councillor Consalvo, yes. Councillor Lamartina?
Yes.
Councillor Lamartina, yes. Councillor Linehan?
Yes.
Councillor Linehan, yes. Councillor Siomo? Councillor Siomo, yes. Councillor Conley?
Yes.
Councillor Conley, yes. Councillor Presley? Councillor Presley, yes. Councillor Arroyo? Councillor Arroyo, yes. Councillor O'Malley? Councillor O'Malley, yes. 11 in the affirmative, 1 negative.
Matter passes 11 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative. Council now moves adjourning, and we shall reconvene on December 8th. All those in favor of adjournment, say aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it.
I request the opportunity to make a statement.
You have the floor.
And I want to make the statement to my supporters. I understand your feelings. I too feel that everyone on the council except Councillor Yancey has made a grievous error. However, this is not the place to express our feelings. They have spoken. We will have the opportunity to speak in September and November of next year. They have judged me today. We will judge them tomorrow. I would ask you at the end of this session to go with me. Wait a minute, please. Please give me respect. I would ask you to go with me. Those who are in this chamber and those who are out in the curly room to go with me downstairs, because we need some time to talk together. Brothers and sisters, some may see this as the end of Chuck Turner because they define me as a counselor. You know that I had 33 years of activism, and I was a leader in this community for 33 years before I became a counselor. Let's go downstairs and talk about what we are going to do to continue to build our power base in this city and make sure we have people on this city council who respect us. Thank you. Yeah.